Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
It is a pleasure to be here in Columbia, South Carolina. And I want to tell you, in the last 48 hours, I've been through much of the South, but I think Columbia, you got some other places beat when it comes to hospitality and graciousness and the beauty of the people that I've met in the time that I've been here. I want to start off by thanking Kiana and the AFAM studies and all of the faculty that took time out of their busy day today to meet with me and eat with me and talk with me and converse with me. It's been a wonderful exchange of ideas and stories and smiles. I also want to acknowledge your dean. It was a pleasure talking to you. And I've met some home folks from Virginia, because I am a Southern girl, although I was told today that's not really the South. But I guess in proximity to South Carolina, it isn't. But I still claim to be a Southern girl. I also would like to thank my friend, the brilliant, the joy-filled, the praying confidant that she is, my sister, Dr. Brigida Johnson. Who I don't think you all fully know what you have here in her. Oh, you do? Okay. I'm glad you do. Because, you know, the quickest way to lose something is to not appreciate something. And so when I met this sister those many years ago, I saw in her so much, and that brilliance is continuing to grow and pour out into her students. And so I also want to acknowledge her students today who lent not only their ears but also their voices as I joined in their class and talked a little bit about some of the work that you're going to hear today. But I promise you that I will not allow my Baptist sensibilities to get the better of me tonight. And so I will be timely tonight. And so I just want to acknowledge how humble and honored I am to be a part of this lecture series. And I acknowledge the work of this ancestor and all of those scholars who have come before me. September 15th, 1963, started off like the typical Sunday morning in Birmingham, Alabama. Many of the black residents of that city began to prepare for their day of worship. In the 16th Street Baptist Church, the oldest and the largest Baptist church in Birmingham, Alabama, the congregants were preparing for Youth Day. The 16th Street Baptist Church, in the months preceding the March on Washington, had become ground zero for the Birmingham movement. It had nightly hosted mass meetings that brought movement leaders, as well as the coalition of activists who had sparked the direct action campaigns throughout the South in discussions of how they could change Birmingham. And shortly after Sunday school on September 15th, that typical but not so typical Sunday morning, Addie Mae Collins, Carol Robinson, Cynthia Wesley, and Denise McNair all gathered in the ladies' lounge basement of the 16th Street Baptist Church. At 10:22 a.m., a bomb that had been positioned not far outside the wall of that ladies' lounge exploded. It is said by those who were present there in Birmingham on that day that the explosion was so powerful, so loud, that it literally shook the church on its foundation. That even people in distance, a wide distance from the church, felt the reverberation of the explosion. When the dust settled, and the smoke dissipated. The congregants of the 16th Street Baptist Church and those within the neighborhood began to search through the rubble of that church. Soon they discovered the bodies of Addie Mae Collins, Carol Robinson, Cynthia Wesley, and Denise McNair. Much like Emmett Till in 1955, they would become symbols of what some people were willing to do to maintain social order. In 1964, many months after the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church, hundreds of young people gathered on the campus of the Western College for Women in Oxford, Ohio. These young people had come from all over the country as a part of an initiative implemented by Robert Moses called the Mississippi Freedom Summer Project. They came to Western College because all of the other area colleges refused to host this contingent of young people. Young people whose sole purpose that summer was to go to Mississippi and to prepare black Mississippians to vote. As they gathered there in Oxford, Ohio, they strategized, they sang. They planned and they thought that what they were going to undertake would change the world. Within weeks of gathering in June of 1964 in Oxford, Ohio, three of the young men who had made their way to Oxford disappeared. While visiting the burned ruins of the Mount Zion Church in Meshebo County, Mississippi, Andrew Goodman, James Chaney, who were members of CORE, and Michael Schwermer, who was a member of SNCC, had all left Oxford in June of 1964, only to be discovered a week later, murdered. These two events, the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church and the Freedom Summer murders, were pivotal moments in the black civil rights struggle of the 1960s. They would mark the beginning of a period of deliberate and accelerated violence that was enacted against the movement. In particular, the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church would mark how the murdering of black children magnified the pain and trauma of black women's experiences in America. While these four little girls became a symbol of the movement, the voices of their mothers, their friends, their cousins, and other women of the community were often lost in the polyphony of male voices that framed the public narrative and the rhetoric of the movement in the racialized aspects of freedom, not the genderized aspects of it. So my work tonight that I will share with you and the work that I've engaged in over the last several years has been about reclaiming these voices from the margins and reclaiming them by specifically looking at the musical reactions, the musical documentation that can be gleaned from the performances of black women musicians. It is my belief that black women like Odetta, like Bernice Johnson, like Fannie Lou Hamer, and like Nina Simone and Aretha Franklin that you will hear from tonight, served as surrogates, as the voices for the voiceless, particularly black women's communal voices and their experiences. The musical reactions to the 16th Street Baptist Church were varied. John Coltrane, who up until that point had remained largely apolitical, composed and performed the melancholy, but also angry, Alabama. Joan Baez, who by 1963 was seen as one of the leading folk musicians in America, recorded the song Birmingham Sunday that memorialized these four young girls. And although it was not a direct answer to the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church, in late 1963, jazz pianist Billy Taylor composed the song I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free. While these are poignant responses to the violence that took place, tonight in these moments that I have been given, I want to focus my lens, focus your ears, to draw your attention to the musical reactions to these moments that were created by two of the poignant voices of the civil rights movement, and who also aligned themselves with the movement in various times in the late 1960s. And those people being Nina Simone and Aretha Franklin. Now, in my presentation, what I also want to do is unpack what I believe is a praxis of black women's anger that is disseminated, performed, and representative of what would become mounting tensions within the movement that would explode in the late 1960s in the form of riots and an urban crisis. Now, and best to understand what I'm advancing here, I think it's important that I deconstruct the mythology of the angry black woman. The image of the angry black woman is one of the prominent ways in which black female identity is readily marketed in our current reality show medium. Shall I call the list? The Housewives of Atlanta, Love and Hip Hop, Growing Up Hip Hop, Bad Girls, you know what I'm talking about. And while this is prominent now, the genesis of this phenomenon can be traced back to slavery, when the black woman's sexuality, body, voice, and attitude was pathologized through characterizations such as the Mammy, Jezebel, and Sapphire. The roots of the angry black woman is Sapphire. As scholar Deborah Gray White asserts in her work, Aren't I a Woman? Female Slaves in the Plantation South, black women were the only women in America that from the start were sexually exploited with impunity, denied economic and reproductive freedom, and worked like oxen. They were denied the full acknowledgement of their identity as women. Therefore, any behavior that stood in opposition to that of the pure, subtle, and fragile white woman was pathologized. In the case of Sapphire, she represented the domineering black woman that consumed black men. Whether Jezebel emasculated black men by stripping them of their ability to resist her sexually. Sapphire emasculated men by usurping their role. She was devoid of maternal compassion and understanding, and she operated in the man's world. She was tough and efficient. This characterization of the strong, aggressive black woman continued to be promoted throughout the 1890s and early 1900s through the minstrel show, but gained more validity in mid-century popular culture through radio and television. The Amos and Andy Show, which began as a serialized radio show, perpetuated through the emasculating wife of George Kingfish Stevens. In time, the terminology shifted from Sapphire to the angry black woman. And this would become more of a characterization following 1960s in the work of E. Franklin Frazier as well as Daniel Moynihan. To the angry black woman, they also would sometimes ascribe the aggressive nature of women in the terminology strong black woman. The use of these labels were used both by the black and white community to stigmatize aggressive black women. In line with the politics of respectability, many women muted their frustrations, positioning the advancement of the race above their specific economic, social, and reproductive struggles. While outside of the community, Black women's anger was viewed as a liability, a justification for othering the experiences of these women. Within the homosocial network of Black women's organizations and social circles, it became the impetus for social change. As Audre Lorde states in her landmark text, Sister Outsider, quote, "Every woman has a well-stocked arsenal of anger, potentially useful against those oppressions, personal and institutional, which brought that anger into being. Focused with precision, it can become a powerful source of energy, serving progress and change. Anger is loaded with information and energy," end of quote. I believe that Audre Lorde's assertions provide a theoretical and cultural lens in which to understand the performance of anger in Black women's musical expression. Close examination of Black women's expressive culture reveals that expressions of anger, frustration, and resistance were never absent or muted. Instead, Black women use writing, dancing, singing, and instrumental performance as spaces where they negotiated their anger, the politics of respectability, and the politics of resistance. Black women musicians wrap their narratives of anger and resistance in musical formats that obscured possible breaches of acceptability. In doing so, their messages were more accessible to their intended audience, white America, and often Black men. Now, my definitional perspective of anger, I want you to understand, is not rooted in the explicit or aggressive performance of emotion. Anger for me is a discursive practice that represents the range of emotions that reflect resistance to, protest against, and rejection of specific social, economic, and political conditions. It is holistic in its context, encompassing domestic relationships as well as systemic and institutional obstacles that undermine the advancement of Black women. And it is represented in a spectrum of ways, from simmering resentment to explicit, loud, amplified vocalizations. And so, this praxis of anger that I am subscribing to is represented, I believe, in three ways. The first is sonic, which is represented in the multivalent and complex ways in which Black people throughout the diaspora realize and produce sound. It is rooted in aesthetical and performance approaches that frame Afro-vocality, which encompasses both the Black speaking voice and the Black singing voice. This is represented in examples such as the bending or the manipulation of a note or pitch, the implementation of timbral changes, changing the color and the tone of the voice, the use of guttural sounds, groans, moans, hums, and screams, and the use of certain vocables that expand the meaning or depth of the lyrics. We've all said, mm. And we all know what that means. The second way that I believe that this anger is performed is rhetorical. And this reflects the complex and highly sophisticated way in which language and words are used by Black people. The discursive and dialectic practices of Black people in America move beyond the surface and the normative uses of words to make a sophisticated and complex web that often takes on multiple meanings depending on audience and who is engaged in dialogue and that environment. My last is embodied. And this speaks to the kinesthetic aspects of anger, which is realized in the performing body. And this can be represented in a myriad of ways. Facial expressions, the use of hands, the motion and tension exhibited by the body, your hand on your hip, the tilt of your head, the squinting of your eyes or the turning of the head in particular ways. Black women and black people in general do not just perform music, it is embodied in their bodies as much as in their voices or the instruments that they hear. Now, while these aesthetical practices of anger frame cultural norms within the discursive practices of blacks, they are often used in more deliberate and sophisticated ways in music performance. In promoting female-centered anger or resistance as part of musical practice, black women often engage in a type of sonic code switching, which proved to be effective in capturing the ears and consciousness of white America. This sonic code switching drew on white popular song conventions that initially obscured the anger or seriousness of the song's prose. In a number of cases, the audiences were drawn into the song or performance in such a way that it is not until the end of the first line of text or prose that the real motive of the song is revealed. And so I'm going to offer two examples of what I am espousing here as this rhetorical practice of anger. The first comes immediately following the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church, when Nina Simone, who at that time was one of the most highly paid and celebrated black women performers in America, has what she calls her Damascus Road moment. Nina Simone was born Eunice Wyman in Tryon, North Carolina, and much of her life is shaped in the politics of segregation and gendered expectation. She was a child prodigy who aspired to be a concert pianist. But when she was rejected by the Curtis Institute of Music, she began playing in the nightclubs of Atlantic City. To obscure the fact that she was playing jazz and blues in these clubs because she came from a religious family, she changed her name to Nina Simone. So Eunice Wyman, sometime around 1956, 1957, became Nina Simone. She came to prominence in the underground club scene of Philadelphia and New Jersey, but by 1963, as I said, she's one of the leading jazz vocalists in America, besides Sarah Vaughan, Dinah Washington, and also Ella Fitzgerald. Up until that point, she had been a passive observer of the movement. But sometime around 1959, 1960, she encountered Langston Hughes, who befriended her. He brought her into a circle of friends that included James Baldwin, as well as Lorraine Hansberry. And she began hanging in the nightclubs of Greenwich Village. And it was there that her consciousness about race and her space in the black civil rights struggle began to take shape. But it is not until the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church that Nina Simone shifts from being a passive observer of the movement to being an active participant in it. She says the following, and I quote, "I was struck dumb in my own den like St. Paul on the road to Damascus. All the truths that I had denied to myself for so long rose up and slapped my face. The bombing of the little girls in Alabama and the murder of Medgar Evers were the final pieces of a jigsaw that made no sense until you had fitted the whole thing together. I suddenly realized what it was to be black in America in 1963. But it wasn't an intellectual connection of the type Lorraine," and she's speaking about Lorraine Hansberry, "had been repeating to me over and over. It came as a rush of fury, hatred, and determination. In church language, the truth entered into me and I came through," end of quote. Searching for an outlet for her anger, Simone went to the piano and in an hour wrote Mississippi Goddamn, her first protest song. The song was not a subtle reading of the struggle for freedom, veiled in Christian-based lyrics of transcendence, such as the freedom songs popularized at mass meetings, or by ensembles like the SNCC Freedom Singers or the Selma Freedom Choir. Mississippi Goddam addressed explicitly a number of political and ideological issues that had emerged out of the movement's coalition. This is Nina Simone. Nina's being Nina. I talked to her before we got started. I thought we was gonna be all right. Okay, I'll tell you what I'm gonna do. Because I've been here before. You all get to see my song list.
The name of the tune is Mississippi Goddam.
Remember what I said about white popular song conventions and how the anger is veiled. Should have noticed how the language dissipates, the laughter dissipates as it moves.
Hound dogs on the train, school children sitting in jail, black cat cross my path. I think every day is gonna be my last. Lord have mercy on this land of mine. We all gonna get it in due time. I don't belong here, I don't belong there. I've even stopped believing in prayer. Don't tell me, I'll tell you. Me and my people just about do. I've been there, so I know. Keep on saying, go slow. But that's just the trouble.
picket lines, school boycotts. They try to say it's a communist plot. All I want is equality for my sister, my brother, my people, and me. Yes, you lied to me all these years. You told me to wash and clean my ears and talk real fine just like a lady. And you'd stop calling me Sister Sadie. Oh, this whole country is full of lies. You all gonna die and die like flies. I don't trust you anymore. You keep on saying, go slow. Go slow. But that's just trouble. Desegregation. Mass participation.
So what I was hoping to show you in the performance is that when Nina Simone would perform this song after 1963, oftentimes what you would see is her beginning to embody the anger as she moved through each stanza. And so by the end of the performance, she's jerking, she's moving. And so in this Mississippi Goddamn, we have a representation of the sonic, the way in which she manipulates the timbre of her voice. She begins the song in a very lyrical, pop song type of idiom. But as she moves into the rhetoric and the things that she is critiquing and scrutinizing, not just about white America, because she's also critiquing black America and the assimilationist politics of the movement, she becomes more agitated. And the timbre of her voice changes. And so in many ways, she's embodying all of those forms of anger that I was talking about. Now, at the same time, shortly after, we have Nina Simone writing Mississippi Goddamn and recording Mississippi Goddamn. So she writes Mississippi Goddamn in 1963. It's recorded in late 63 and released in 1964. So Mississippi Goddamn is coming into play just as Freedom Summer is taking place. But in 1964, one of her peers, Aretha Franklin, is the new singer at Columbia Records. Aretha, who you know as the Queen of Soul, was not quite the Queen of Soul at that time. Columbia was the first manifestation of her shifting from gospel music and the incubator of the black church into the public music spectrum. But much of her consciousness was much more developed than Nina Simone's, where Simone had simply taken this notion that if she assimilated and if she followed certain protocols of respectability, that they would equal to her achieving her dreams. Aretha Franklin had been schooled in the hard knocks of the gospel highway. While traveling the gospel circuit with her father, the famous Reverend C.L. Franklin, alongside the Staple Singers, ironically, who would become leading voices in the movement in the late 60s as well. She had faced directly segregation, the politics of segregation, the difficulties of traveling America, Southern America, as a black person. And in the months prior to the March on Washington, her father, Reverend C.L. Franklin, sponsored one of the, at that time, was the largest civil rights rally in Detroit, where it is said that Dr. King first did the first iteration of the I Have a Dream speech. That particular march drew over 200,000 people and was only rivaled in size and attendance by the March on Washington. And although Aretha was not present at that march in 1963, she was an ardent supporter of Dr. King and the movement. So here we have another black woman who is operating in the role of an artist activist. But few people do not ascribe any musical consciousness or connection between Aretha Franklin and the civil rights movement until 1967, when she signs to Atlantic Records. It is then that she records her famous debut album for Atlantic, I Never Loved a Man the Way That I Love You. And people heard in particular the first single from that album, a song called Respect, as being emblematic of her connection with black power, black nationalist, and civil rights rhetoric. But in 1964, while doing a series of recording sessions with a producer and writer by the name of Clyde Otis, Aretha Franklin records what is her first civil rights song, a song that embedded her in the rhetoric of the civil rights movement at that time, and also embedded her in the reaction of Freedom Summer and the 16th Street church bombing. We know this because Clyde Otis, much later on in talking about these particular sessions, says that Aretha, when he took that song to Aretha, that she accepted it, embraced it, knew its message, understood its message, and thought that it was important to record the song. He says this, and I quote, he said, Aretha's no cliche. When you listen to Take a Look, she's singing for all of humanity. She's singing about the deepest mysteries out there, why evil is so strong. Remember, we are creating this album during what they were calling the Freedom Summer. We were all shocked when all three of those volunteers, Michael Shermer, Andrew Goodman, and James Chaney, had been shot to death in cold blood by the Klan in Mississippi. Their only crime was trying to register black voters. So when Aretha was singing, Take a Look, that's what she wanted people to look at, the violence in Mississippi. So let's hear Aretha. And I don't think Aretha's gonna play, so give me a moment. This is 1964, Aretha Franklin, Columbia Records.
Don't you look too close, 'cause you just might see the person that you hate the most. Lord, what's happening to race? I can't even see one friendly face. Brothers, fight brothers, and sisters, wink their eyes, while silver tongues bear fruits of poison. Take a look at your children, born
So, powerful song, which the musical accompaniment does not in any way reflect what the lyrics are. And so I think you all are getting what I'm saying about the very systemic and sophisticated ways in which black women sought to articulate what was this anger and tension. And I know that I'm getting short on time, so I will be quick in my summation. Farrah Jasmine Griffin says that the black woman's singing voice can signal a crisis in the spectacle of national unity, that it can even invoke such a crisis by mobilizing dissent and forging a space of resistance. Representations of the voice suggest that it is like a hinge, a place where things can both come together and break apart. And this is exactly what we hear in both Mississippi Goddamn and Take a Look, as both foreshadow for us what is the falling apart of the coalition of movement organizations that had spurred and progressed the black civil rights struggle during the early 1960s. Their songs also point to the simmering anger and tension that will boil over to the surface in northern urban cities beginning in 1965 and extending through 1967, the red hot summer, where in America there will be hundreds of urban insurrections or riots, most of which will be in the North and in the West. They also point to us what is the advancing secularization of the freedom song, as both Mississippi Goddamn and Take a Look point to what will be emerging trends in protest music by the late 1960s. We oftentimes point to James Brown's Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud as the pivotal point of articulating black nationalistic themes. But I challenge you to listen to Nina Simone and Aretha Franklin, for in them, they provide us the prophetic voice of the violence that would come to define the late 1960s and precipitate the rise of anger amongst black women. Thank you. People have questions. I think we have a little time for questions. If people have questions. Yes. Yes. So you said the Africanist and.
The European aesthetics.
So okay.
The text.
Yes. Yes. So I think what you're asking me to do is really talk about what I hear centrally in each one of these songs. I think there are some very astute dramatic pauses. First of all, I think what both of these women are drawing on aesthetically is black sermonic traditions, especially Aretha Franklin. I think much of Aretha Franklin's interpretations of lyrics and how she cadences, how she phrases those cadences was rooted in the way in which her father preached, right? That she really was modeling. I think also they understood, as some people sometimes tell me when I speak, those dramatic pauses draw interest to the words, right? And in some cases, that's very Africanist. It really speaks to those very layered ways that I was talking about how Africans can use sometimes silence. And I know that some of you all have seen me in the Miles Davis documentary. I think one of the most powerful things that Miles does as a player is that he uses silence as a compositional device. He uses it as a performance aesthetic. So if you listen to Miles Davis versus a Dizzy Gillespie, Dizzy Gillespie will feel a measure with so many notes. A Miles Davis will play a note and let it linger, but it will take in everything that is around it. And I think what you hear, especially in both of these women, is the dramatic pauses in many ways allows people to catch their breath in the midst of their mind catching up with their ear in terms of what is really being said, but also in some ways helping them resolve the tension by the use of the strings and all of these conventional devices that we ascribe to white popular music. I think I answered your question. Did I answer it? My sister, congratulations as well, too. I meant to congratulate. You're not Maya. I'm sorry. You are Maya. And I meant to congratulate you in my opening thing. Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
But how did you find the courage to start and just really find your journey and like sort of become who you are? What was that journey, or what advice do you have for students?
Do not subscribe to success templates.
No.
Avoid success templates. People will tell you if you go to this school, if you major in this, if you do this, it will present these outcomes. And oftentimes that can be a setup. What I would suggest is finding your own pathway. I started out my career wanting to be a concert pianist because I had played since the age of 3. And when I got to Virginia State, it became very evident to me very quickly that was not going to be my calling. I didn't have the stomach, I didn't have the stamina, and I didn't have the hand size. And I had a teacher who told me so. And while that broke my heart, it forced me to look beyond. And sometimes college can be that space, and that's what you need to use it for. You are here to acquire knowledge. You are not here to find a job. And see, we get that mixed up. We get that mixed up because we think that we come here and we go through these classes, and these classes are going to equate into a career in a college. You are here to get knowledge. And what I learned in my undergrad years was that I had a love for history and I had a love for music. I intended on being a public school music teacher. And then in the midst of my student teaching experience in a middle school that was 98% black and Latino, but the faculty was 98% white, that I found students who were bored, right, being disciplined. And so as a young college student, I was trying to find things to integrate into the classroom that led me to musicology. And meant that I took a whole different career path, had to learn whole new things, had to start over, move to some places I knew nobody, but I operated in faith. And that's the other thing you gotta have. Regardless of what you're gonna call your faith in, you gotta understand who you are and what your purpose is going to be. And while I didn't know my purpose, I knew what I wanted to do. I knew that I wanted to write black people. I knew I wanted to write women because I knew women who sang in my community. And I couldn't understand why I stood in classes that called themselves exposing me to bases of knowledge but did not talk about me, who I was and what I had heard and all that I knew about music. And so that started me on a journey. And it's been trips. So what you don't hear in my bio is all the things I made mistakes at. What you don't hear is how many times I was still willing to push. You don't hear how many people told me you can't do that. You're not gonna do that. You're not gonna be successful or whatever. You have to be willing to know. But that means you have to spend the time to invest in yourself, to hear your voice. That means that you have to spend the time to listen to the wisdom of elders and know even when they correct you that it is in love. But most of all, you have to stop looking at what everybody else does and say, you know what? If I fail, at least I tried. Don't be afraid of failure. Because sometimes failure can lead you to your purpose. I said I started my role as a failed concert pianist, but I found my purpose as a music historian. So trust the process, but not the success template. And acquire every bit of knowledge you can. I took every class I could. Ohio State was paying for my tuition. They didn't know I was over there in AFAM studies and women's studies and American history because I took not one class in African American music. See, you all think that is Burger King or Golden Corral. You come to colleges and you say, well, you don't have this major, you don't have that thing, you don't have, and then y'all get upset. Make your own. You come from a history of people who have made their own. Do it. Find it. Study. Acquire the knowledge. And then go for it. You are. And I know y'all gonna say that's simple, and that was Oprah and Iyanna Vancent, but that's true. That comes out of lived experience. Just don't be afraid to fail. Y'all, don't be afraid to fail. Failure is sometimes the best tool for learning.
That's right. Thank you. I had 1,000 questions, but they were all personal.
Okay.
And then I heard what this young lady had did. And then I got to thinking, could you speak to her and all the other young people, and even me, about the song Young, Gifted, and Black that Nina Simone and Aretha both did?
Yes. Okay. So Nina Simone wrote that song in honor of her friend Lorraine Hansberry, who wrote A Raisin in the Sun. Lorraine Hansberry was a very close and confident friend of Nina Simone. And so she was very much influenced and impacted positively and negatively about the premature death of Lorraine Hansberry. She wanted to write something that was a message to young people about who they were and what they stood for in the late 1960s. It was why I said what I said to you and all these other young people. She said to be young, gifted, and black is where it's at, you know? And so when you look at the confluence of those words, young, to be young, because to be young is a time of experimentation. It's a time for adventure. It's a time to explore, to be gifted. Sometimes we forget that we are gifted because the world makes us think that our gifts have to be defined or measured in accordance to someone else's gift. And so oftentimes we can not fully explore who we are or what we desire to do because we look at someone else and we see their confidence or their success. And so what she was saying is that we are all gifted. The acknowledgement, the embracing of that gift is what's important. And your gift may be whatever. Your gift may be the gift of hospitality. Your gift may be recitation. Your gift may be you are able to compute math problems or whatever. But acknowledge and find your gifts and black. The invoking of the word black in the late 1960s was quite revolutionary. For many of you all in this room, we have known that term in varying degrees. We've known it as a term of disparagement. We've known that as a term of othering us, right? But in the late 1960s, that meaning was being reclaimed. The politics of reclamation by black people. In not only this country, but in the diaspora, as a term of affirmment, of community, of not just your identity, but as an awareness of your ancestral past and how that is intersecting with your present state and how that intersection would ultimately define what your future would be. And so that combination, young, gifted, and black, was to her a testimony, a prayer, a wish, a hope for that generation, the generation that came behind her to realize their potential and their power and the promise that her generation did not know when it came to America and democracy. So, one more question. Yes, sir. Yep.
Dinah Washington.
Dinah Washington, what about her?
Just tell me how you feel about her.
I love Dinah Washington. And I want to tell you that, ironically, the song that I played was Columbia's attempt at that time to christen. It was a part of a series of recordings made by Columbia to christen Aretha Franklin as the next queen. So we think that that's a late soul 60s thing. It was actually being marketed in the early 1960s because Columbia, when it signed Aretha, did not envision Aretha to be the soul singer that she was. They were trying to turn her into the next Dinah Washington and the next Billie Holiday. They wanted her to be a jazz singer. So that's why you hear all of those strings and all those pop devices, right? And so Dinah Washington dies in 1963. And not long after she dies, John Hammond, who is the person who signed her to Columbia, began crafting what he thought would be this sound and this marketing scheme to declare Aretha Franklin as the next queen, replacing Dinah Washington. It failed. It failed tremendously. And I think largely because while Aretha could sing any and everything under the sun, that was not her essence. It was not her purpose. That was not her place. It's not until she gets to Atlantic. And what Atlantic does that's very smart is that they let Aretha do Aretha. So they would bring her just bits of songs. She would sit at the piano. So most of those early recordings you hear from 1967 to 1970, that's Aretha playing. And Aretha worked out all of the arrangements, the horns, the voices, her and her sisters, that sock it to me, R-E-S-V-P-C-T, that wasn't even in Otis Redding's song. Her and her sisters sat down. So Aretha became the architect of her sound. And when she became the architect of her sound, she combined that Saturday morning, Saturday night, and that Sunday morning, and a nice little confluence of black nationalism and her awareness as a black woman, and that's how you get respect. And that's how you get I Never Loved a Man. And that's how you get Do Right Woman, because they let her be the essence of who she was. One more question, brother, can I? The historian. Well, you ain't gonna rip me up now.
Thank you so very much for what you've offered. I will just say as an aside, I appreciate that you didn't put away all of your Baptist sentences. But I was going to ask if, very quickly, I was going to ask, how does black humor and black anger work in conjunction? Because I heard aspects of both in these songs. And then there was also some subtle demand that you might play a little for us.
Yes. Okay, I might just play. Hopefully I can draw up some more voice. I didn't use it all in my dramatic pauses. you know what? I never thought about the black comedy thing until you just said it. And I'm like, ooh, yeah, Dick Gregory, Red Fox. I think there could be a thing there, but I haven't looked at that. Is that a possible collaboration we could do? Okay.
I guess what I'm referencing is that Nina starts off
with
the laugh.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's good. And it also draws back to those conventions of black performers had to use before World War II. You know, when you think of, you see Louis Armstrong, right, laughing, and the things that brought him critique, right, that really drew white audiences and made them comfortable. Yes. So, bro, I'm going to write your name down so that I can quote you. I'm going to work on that. That's a good way of looking. I hadn't looked at the comedic aspects of that, but yes, that may be. Yes. So you all want me to play?
Yeah. Okay.
Hmm. Okay, I don't know what I'm gonna play and say. So, you know, I'm at Miami University, and I stated in my paper that Miami was the site of the Freedom Summer project, and so I've had an opportunity to deal with that. I did a song this morning in Brigida's class, and I think I'll end with this because I think it is so poignant and relevant to now, and even offering it up in remembrance of Charleston, the Charleston Nine. Can I tell you a short story before to lead up to the song? So in talking with one of the many activists who went to Mississippi in 1964, this activist told me that the morning that James Chaney and Andrew Goodman and Schwerner disappeared, that Bob Moses came to them. He gathered everyone in the theater on the Western College campus, and he said, you know, he told them that the activists were missing. And he said, we're just gonna assume they're dead. They are dead. You just don't go to Mississippi and disappear, and you not end up dead. And she told me very poignantly, she said, at that moment that Bob Moses said to them, you have a choice to make. You can choose to go home and no one will judge you, or you can forge forward and go to Mississippi. But if you go to Mississippi, there's two things that you have to do. The first thing that you must do is you must write a letter to your family, and you must tell your family that you have chosen to go to Mississippi. Then no one has forced you. This is your choice. You've been elected to do this as part of this movement of social change. He said the second thing that she said, the second thing that he told him, he said, after you write that letter, you must write your last will and testament. And she said, they sat there. I want you to imagine, I asked the students this morning to imagine that you are 18 and 19 years old. You may even be 20 years old, and you've left your home. Some of you may have left college because you have been spurred into a movement of social change based on what you saw on television, what was happening in Mississippi. She said that they sat there very quietly, and nobody moved, nobody said anything. And she said in a few minutes, they began to sing. And they just kept singing, and they started crying, and they started writing. And she said, you know, they moved from song to song to song until everybody was finished, and they dispersed and went their own way. And she said that one of the songs that they sang was a song that we sometimes misunderstand in our contemporary context of songs in the popular domain. And I told the class this morning, I first learned this song in Girl Scout camp. And it was wrongly attributed when I first learned this song. But now I've come to understand the importance of this song and how the activists who were involved in the movement saw this not just simply as a song, but as a prayer, as a desire, as a prophecy of what would come as they faced danger. And so I'm gonna end with this song. And I think I can sing, but it don't sound like it's supposed to sound, just forgive me. Here, my Lord, come by here. Come by here, my Lord. Come by here, oh Lord. We need you, Lord, to come. Come by here. People are dying, Lord. Here, ooh, don't you see that people are dying, Lord? We need you to come, come by here. People are dying, Lord. Come by here. Won't you come, come by come by here.